Today is May 24th, 2020, the seventh Sunday of Easter. This Memorial Day weekend, we remember all those who gave their lives in wars and other hostilities. These are our sons, daughters, our brothers and sisters, our fathers and mothers, whose lives were tragically cut short in violent conflict. Today, we also approach the end of the Easter season. We listen to Jesus pray for his disciples. We hear his disciples' devotion to prayer after Jesus ascended to the Father. May our prayers today connect us with those who are no longer with us. Please lead us greet our celebrant, Father Victor.
A church which is struggling to see what it means today to carry out Christ's commandments. Love one another just as I have loved you. And also today we remember all those who have gone before us, those from this parish, those who in service to this country represented us in different conflicts, and those who passed on account of the pandemic that we're going through at this time. Our God is a God of love. Our God is a God of mercy. And as we gather to celebrate, let us celebrate with understanding and faith that yes, indeed, he forgives.
Lord, have mercy.
Graciously hear our supplications, O Lord, so that we who believe that the Savior of the human race is with you in your glory may experience, as he promised, until the end of the world, his abiding presence among us, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
After Jesus had been taken up to heaven, the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. When they entered the city, they went to the upper room where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these devoted themselves with one accord to prayer, together with some women and Mary, the mother of Jesus and his brothers. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The responsorial psalm. I believe that I shall see the good things of the Lord in the land of the living. I believe that I shall see the good things of the Lord in the land of the living. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my life's refuge. Of whom should I be afraid? I believe that I shall see the good things of the Lord in the land of the living. One thing I ask of the Lord, this I seek, to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, that I may gaze on the loveliness of the Lord and contemplate his temple. I believe that I shall see the good things of the Lord in the land of the living. Hear, O Lord, the sound of my call. Have pity on me and answer me. Of you my heart speaks, you my glance seeks. I believe that I shall see the good things of the Lord in the land of the living.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, rejoice to the extent that you share in the sufferings of Christ, so that when his glory is revealed, you may also rejoice exultantly. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, blessed are you. For the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. But let no one among you be made to suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as an intriguer. But whoever is made to suffer as a Christian should not be ashamed, but glorify God because of the name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus raised his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Give glory to your Son, so that your Son may glorify you, just as you gave him authority over all people, so that your Son may give eternal life to all you gave him. Now this is eternal life, that they should know you, the only true God, and the one whom you sent, Jesus Christ. I glorified you on earth by accomplishing the work that you gave me to do. Now glorify me, Father, with you, with the glory that I had with you before the world began. I revealed your name to those whom you gave me out of the world. They belonged to me, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you gave me is from you, because the words you gave to me, I have given to them. And they accepted them and truly understood that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for the ones you have given me, because they are yours, and everything of mine is yours. And everything of yours is mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I will no longer be in the world, but they are in the world, while I am coming to you. Sisters and brothers, the good news of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Children in a refugee camp. They were actually a mixed bunch. Some of them have come from the urban area or big city, and the others came from the countryside. All of them were there for one reason. And that is to escape the hunger and the fighting of a bitter civil war which was raging throughout their land. And one day, their teacher asked them if any one of them had a riddle or a puzzle. And one of those, a 9-year-old, spoke up and said, yes, I have this puzzle. And he went on to say that a dog was running along a path one day, looking for something to eat because it was hungry. And suddenly, as he was on this prowl looking for food, he suddenly came upon a fork in the path. On one side, there was a rabbit. And then on the other side, there was also a rabbit. And the dog wanted both rabbits. So the dog ran both ways. And in doing so, the dog tore itself in half, down the middle, and died. And so the teacher turned to this group of children, those from the city and those from the countryside, and asked them what they thought about the story. Those group of kids or children from the city, they were shocked and shook their heads and said that the story couldn't possibly be true. It was impossible, they said, for a dog to tear itself in half like that. But the children from the countryside said, of course it's true. And their rationale was, it's true because greed kills. So we have the same thing. We have the same situation, but we have two different groups. And we see that the two different groups, what they thought about the same thing, the same situation, was very different. Sisters and brothers, adults too have the same problem as those children. And why do I say so? In the gospel of today, Jesus talks about knowing God, that we have to know God. He tells us that eternal life is to know God. But the question is, what does he mean by that when he says that eternal life is to know God? First of all, the first question is, does he mean that we need to know everything about God, like you will know a book, or like you will know a car, the anatomy and the physiology of something? Or is it more like knowing a person, having a relationship with someone, so that you can say that, yes, I know that person, I know what he or she thinks, and I know what he or she likes or dislikes? We all probably have our own ideas about what it means to know God. But let's look at what Jesus' hearers have made of it all, as we hear in the scriptures. The gospel we read this morning is from the Gospel of John. And it is a gospel passage written by John, but while he wrote, it was written under the influence of both Greek and Israelite thought or influences. Both groups had very different notions, very different knowledge or ideas of what it would have meant to know God. The Greeks, on one part, would have seen it as a highly abstract thought or form of contemplation, something which took them away from the confusion and the mess of daily life. The Israelites, on the other hand, saw things in a much more practical and down-to-earth manner. For them, to know God is to enter into a relationship with him. Knowing God involved obeying his commandments, which dealt with how we relate and deal with one another. So this morning we ask the question, what do we make of all this? What do we make of to know God? You find out that in the early church, probably, yes, In the early church, there is a fusion of both ideas. Yes, contemplation was important, was necessary, but only in the context of a practical living out of the gospel. If it doesn't make sense in their lives and draw them closer to God, then it's not significant. Our society today, yes, live in constant anxiety. Anxiety over a lot of things. And immediately anxiety over the pandemic that we are fighting these days. But also before now, we have other concerns. Anxieties over, yes, there was a time we had anxiety over the stock market, how the stock market is doing. You have anxiety over, oh, do we have enough jobs? Are our wages, salaries that are paid to people fair? Fair and equitable for all workers? Are our policies fair and justifiable? These are valid concerns. But for us Christians, for us believers, they should not be, and they are not, the top concerns that we have. Because when economics is our top concern, we push everything else to the periphery, including prayer. Prayer is something that is relegated to an hour on Sunday, since that is all of the time many people feel that we need prayer. But the readings this morning speak of the priority of prayer. The disciples were told in our first reading, spend your time in prayer after the ascension of Jesus, when Jesus left them. These men and women who had witnessed much and experienced great emotional highs and lows in the past couple of months now took time to pray. And this prayer aided them, helped them to reflect and ask for understanding about all that had happened in their lives these past days. Sisters and brothers, these days more than ever, we need prayers. Prayers for ourselves, surviving this pandemic. Prayers for those who have gone before us, yes, on account of the virus. Prayers for understanding, to understand all that happens, not just in our lives personally, but also in the lives of those around us. Prayers for an understanding of what is happening in our society. St. Paul reminds us that when we sacrifice something for prayer, we will find blessing. Making time for prayer will help us. Making time for prayer will aid us in becoming closer to God, in becoming closer to those near to us, and in becoming, yes, closer to everyone else. Because prayer is a conversation. Prayer is a dialogue. And we need to increase that dialogue with our God. It is worth our time. It is worth of our being above all other things. Prayer should be our lifeblood as believers. And so, sisters and brothers, we pray that God will save us from all adversities, will save us from all tragedies, but that we also pray that God will keep us all whole, that yes, indeed, we will survive this pandemic. And we pray for all those on this Memorial Day who have given all, made the ultimate sacrifice in service of others. They were not selfish with their life. They gave their lives so that others may have peace and life. As the scripture says, greater love than this no person has ever had, that one should lay down his life for his friends. That's what Jesus did for us. And those people that we remember today on this memorial day did exactly that. They gave their lives, sacrificed their life that we may have life and life to the fullest. So we pray for all of them, and we pray that yes, indeed, they are in a much more peaceful and blissful place. May their souls rest in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Guided by the Spirit of God, we celebrate today, we pray. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became flesh. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Sisters and brothers, on the final evening Jesus spent with his disciples, he prayed to his Father for those he loved in the world. And so let us pray today for the needs of our community and for the needs of all whom God loves.
Please respond, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our holy church, that we may be one accord, devote ourselves to building the kingdom of God in the world today. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who gave their lives in armed conflict and for their families and loved ones, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who suffer in mind or body from physical or mental illness, from physical or emotional trauma, and from hardships of all kinds, that their sufferings may be softened as they are joined with Christ's sufferings for us all. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For our parish community, that we may glorify God in the way we live out our commitment to the gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those who are suffering or are sick on account of COVID-19, that the message of God's love may bring them comfort in their distress and inspire others to provide care and understanding. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For for the souls lost through the coronavirus, that they may find eternal rest and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all of our prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts, for all of our intentions spoken and unspoken, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
God in heaven, you raised up your Son Jesus, who now sits at your right hand in glory. Listen to the prayers we make here on earth and grant them through your Son, our risen and ascended Lord. We pray through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful with the sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devotedness we may pass over to the glory of heaven. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For after his resurrection, he plainly appeared to all his disciples and was taken up to heaven in their sight, that he might make us sharers in his divinity. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Sending down your spirit upon them like they do fall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to all of his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when the supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to all of his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and confess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection. We offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Timothy, our Bishop, and all your clergy and religious. And remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and with Saint Aloysius, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, All glory and honor is yours forever. And unity in accordance with your holy will lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Peace.
Thank you. the night. He'll replace wrong with right.
Let us pray. Hear us, O God, our Savior, and grant us confidence that through these sacred mysteries, there will be accomplished in the body of the whole church what has already come to pass in Christ our Herod, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Daniel, thank you very much.
Thank you, Father.
For that song, very prayerful song, particularly on this day that we celebrate Memorial Day. This weekend we celebrate Memorial Day. And once again, I want to thank the youth for organizing these masses we've been having live streaming since Easter. For those who think that the youth cannot be, there's no constancy, or cannot be constant and determination, they have been here every Sunday. And for that, I am grateful, and in the name of Operationers, I want to thank you guys. And of course, our friend Danny. I remember what the scripture says. They are no longer two, but now one flesh. So each time where Danny is, there is Olivia. And we want to thank
I use that word again, indefatigable. Okay.
And today, Dave and Daniel not only sang that song,
but also represented the parish. So thank you. Thank you very much.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless us all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Sisters and brothers, our mass is now ended. And once again, we go in peace to continue to love. and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Have a blessed work weekend and a wonderful Sunday.
Safe weekend.